So Ebola virus disease has been in the news, and today is September 16th, and I just want to mark that on the calendar so we can keep track of kind of where things are as they stand today. And these Western African countries are kind of where we're seeing the disease: Nigeria and Liberia, Sierra Leone, Guinea, and also Senegal, all combined have more than 4,000 folks that have been sick with Ebola, and actually over 2,000 people have died of Ebola. And I just want to contrast that with kind of geographically, kind of where we've seen past outbreaks that are big. And when I say big, none of the past outbreaks have even compared with the size of the current outbreak. But also the geography is different. You see, in the past, it's been more Central Africa. And so those are kind of two interesting points about the current outbreak. And while we're talking about Central Africa, I thought it would be kind of worth noting where the name of Ebola comes from. Actually, there's a river down here in Central Africa. Back in 1976, there was the first outbreak that we tracked, and it was actually named after the Ebola River because that's the region where this was first noticed. So this current outbreak, to understand it in its magnitude, I think it's useful to kind of take a little bit of a larger view and understand how it transmits or how it spreads in the natural environment. And usually, these guys that I'm kind of shading in green, these guys are thought to be kind of one of the animals out there that may be kind of spreading the disease around. So fruit bats are one of the culprits that people suspect. And they also actually get sick with Ebola. And so this one I kind of sketched in green. And when they get sick, they can spread it to other bats in their bat community. And this becomes then the community becomes a natural reservoir. We call this natural reservoir of disease or of virus. And this is where it kind of circulates normally. And so we wouldn't even think about Ebola if it was only affecting bats, probably wouldn't worry about it too much. But what happens is that every once in a while, it affects a human. And the way that this might happen is, let's say this person goes in their front yard and they notice a dead bat or a sick bat, and they try to care for it, and they might get some blood or stool from that bat on their hand, and it can kind of go into a wound. Maybe they have a cut, or it can go kind of in their mouth, or if they rub their eyes or nose. So all of a sudden, the virus now has a way into the person. And so that's kind of how we think that first person might get sick. And that first person, we actually have a special name, especially if there's an outbreak. And that name is an index case. We say that this person is the very first person who got sick with the disease here, Ebola. And now looking at our calendar, if this person got sick on the 16th today, then their first symptoms are not going to be today. They're going to happen in a couple of days, all the way through 3 weeks. So really kind of a long window in terms of when their first symptoms might happen. It could be this month. It might even be all the way through next month, because the 7th of October would be 3 weeks. And generally, we notice that symptoms happen kind of in this window I'm going to draw right here. So 7 to 10 days, that's when their very first symptoms start to appear. So they're not immediate. And the first symptoms are kind of vague. They're things like, they might feel a little feverish, or they might get like a little headache, maybe some muscle aches. So kind of just general symptoms, not feeling very well. And at this point, people think, well, maybe it could be anything, some flu or something. So they don't usually go and try to get medical help. But then what happens is that the virus kind of spreads through the immune system and starts getting into all sorts of different tissues. And it can cause problems in their stomach. They might want to vomit or have diarrhea. It can go to their lungs. I'm shading in their lungs. They can might, start coughing. It can cause rashes. It can cause, muscle aches. It can cause redness of the eyes, conjunctivitis, we call that. It can also cause inflammation around the brain itself, meningitis, or it can cause bleeding of the nose or the mouth, the gums. And in fact, that bleeding is really classic because we think of the virus traveling in the blood. And so bleeding is a really important thing to notice because it's very, very transmissible. People can get it from the blood. And the word for virus in the blood is kind of viremic. Vir is virus. In this case, it's the Ebola virus. And emic means in the blood. So when the virus is in the blood, we would say they're viremic. And at this point, they might say, well, I want to go and get the help of a doctor. And so if they go to get medical help, the kinds of things that they usually would get would be like IV fluids if they're dehydrated, if they're having difficulty, let's say, breathing, they might get some oxygen. If their blood pressure is low, They might get some medications to help their blood pressure kind of come back up to normal. So these are the kind of things that people do. And, you know, in Western Africa, they have all this support out there. You know, they have medical tents set up to kind of help people that have Ebola. And so all the care they're giving is considered supportive care. And there's no real specific anti-Ebola medication. Again, we're here on September 16th and people are researching it. But at the moment, there is really just supportive care to help people that are sick and nothing specific that targets the virus. Now, the worrisome thing, this is now just, I want you to just kind of wrap your head around this, is that with supportive care, what we're seeing in this outbreak, on average, is a 50% or so fatality rate, meaning for two people with Ebola, one will die. I mean, it's a flip of a coin, which is frightening. I mean, if you come down with these symptoms and you're waiting to find out if you have Ebola or not, or if you've just found out, that's a really, really scary proposition that half of the people with this diagnosis are gonna die. And that's exactly the reason why the world is kind of watching and intervening and helping to make sure that we get this under control. So in addition to supportive care, the other big area that we kind of think about is how do you avoid transmitting the virus from one person to another? So let me just sketch in a second person here. So here I've drawn a second person, and the question becomes, how does Ebola get from the first person to the second person? How exactly does it move? And the quick answer is that it moves through bodily fluids. So bodily fluids include everything from blood to vomit and diarrhea or stool. And these are kind of the big ones, especially blood, very, very infectious. But also stool and vomit, because a lot of these patients are sick. And bodily fluids could also be things like saliva and sweat. But again, these first few that I've kind of written out are the ones to really keep in mind. And blood, in fact, is an interesting one. There was a study that I think is pretty cool and kind of illustrates the point where they showed that one drop, just one drop of blood from a monkey that had Ebola was enough to carry with it a million little Ebola virus particles. And that was thought to be enough to infect a million monkeys. So kind of the idea that one single drop could be enough to really decimate a population. So it kind of drives home the point that if there's a drop of blood, just a single drop or another bodily fluid that really gets over, let's say, over into this person's hand, and they can kind of go from there to, if they touch their face, it can get entry into their body through their nose or eyes or mouth. Or let's say they have a little cut, it could actually make its way into the blood through that cut. So a few kind of interesting ways that bodily fluid can travel, but really then it gets a ticket into the second person, and the second person can get sick. And of course, that could happen with stool or vomit as well. Now, another question that I think a lot of people ask is, what about airborne? You know, can you breathe this stuff in? And that's a big question. And the idea, I think, is literally, is it kind of floating in the air? And the answer is no. You know, it's not really like other viruses like measles and some other ones where it's airborne. So let me just cross that out so it's very clear. It is not airborne. In fact, I think a lot of the confusion comes when you think about things like sneezes. So with a sneeze, you can imagine like kind of, you know, we've all seen those sneezes or had those sneezes where kind of a big droplet of goo or mucus kind of goes out, and you get this kind of shower, right, of droplets, and these kind of right around where you're standing, just right in your immediate vicinity. And that's not going to affect anyone that's kind of standing away from you. And you could imagine maybe in kind of a strange scenario, let's say there's a person kind of hanging out right here, right next to somebody's shoulder, and they're just kind of sitting there. They might get hit in the face with one of these droplets, and maybe then you could say, well, you know, therefore they got hit and they're sick with Ebola. But again, it's the droplet, which is a bodily fluid, and not the fact that they were just breathing, you know, air like someone that was standing away. So that's not a typical scenario, and that's why we don't call this airborne. One quick thing I should mention is that you can get virus that kind of hits a surface. And if it hits a surface like a table or the floor, it can actually survive on that surface, they think, for days to weeks. And so it is an important point, because then that means that if someone's been in a room, you really have to decontaminate that area and get rid of all those little dried up droplets that are sitting on the surface to make sure that that room is actually really quite clean again. So what it boils down to is that the real way to kind of prevent the spread of this disease is to make sure that these folks are isolated if they are sick with the illness. And over here, all the caretakers, they should be wearing protective clothing. They should be wearing gloves, you know, to make sure that they don't get blood on their hands. They should be wearing gowns to cover up the rest of their body so that they don't expose any kind of wounds or cuts or anything like that. They should be also protecting their mouth with a mask and goggles as well. And so this is actually exactly in the nose. So all of this should be kind of covered up. And so even working in these conditions can be really tough. I mean, these full body suits can get very, very hot, and it can be very, very difficult to work in these conditions. But this is really what you want to see to isolate Ebola from one person not getting to another. And in addition to just hospital workers, of course, you also have to remember the fact that it's going to be, you know, funeral directors that are working with dead bodies, which can actually, again, spread virus. Believe it or not, a dead body can actually spread for weeks after the person has died. It can be lab workers that are dealing with specimens, or family members actually are huge. So all these different people at risk. And by doing this, you basically prevent the virus from spreading and hopefully end this scourge that's happened in Western Africa.